Kyle Longley is the Snell Family Dean's Distinguished Professor in History and Political Science at Arizona State University. He is the author of 6 books, including The Morenci Marines, Small Town in the Shadow of the Vietnam War, which was published in 2013, Grunts, the American Combat Soldier in Vietnam from 2008, and Senator Albert Gore, Sr., Tennessee Maverick from 2004. The title for today's lecture is his most recent book, The Morenci Marines, A Tale of a Small Western Town and the Vietnam War. Please join me in welcoming to BYU Professor Kyle Longley.
I'm very happy to be here today. This is my first trip to Provo. Only time else I've been in Salt Lake City, usually stop at the airport going somewhere else, but it's a remarkably beautiful place. I'm happy to be here, although it is a lot colder than I left in Phoenix yesterday. It's 70 yesterday and hit the place last night. I'm like, not in Phoenix anymore.
Oh, that's right, I'm sorry. I'm a hyperactive type person, so I usually move around a lot, but I will try to stay put today. I'm here to talk to you about a small little town in Arizona and the impact of the Vietnam War. And before I start, I want you to do me a favor. Close your eyes. Take and put on each side of you 4 of your best friends. 4 on one side, 4 on the other. Keep that visual with you. I'm going to come back to it in just a minute. Today I'm going to talk about a group of 9 young men from the small mining town of Morenci, Arizona, who decided to join the Marine Corps in July of 1966. Just to sort of give you some feeling for where this is, if you look at the map, you can see the sort of state of Arizona. Most people in Arizona couldn't tell you where Morenci is, much less people outside of the state. But it is a very important little place, second largest open pit copper mine in the world. Still today, a company-dominated town by Freeport-McMoRan, as in this day and time when they're there, it's going to be dominated by Phelps Dodge. But again, you sort of get a feel for it. Southeastern, you're almost to New Mexico and to places like Silver City. Morenci, you can see sort of here, is built into a hillside. And I love this little quote from an Irish priest in 1962, Eugene O'Carroll. Remember walking out of his house the first day and writing his mother in Ireland. I'm in a shanty in an old shanty town. This is a company town. Again, all built around one product, copper. It's company town means the company owns the housing. It owns the hospitals. It owns all elements of life. It owns the land. It tells you where you can live, how you can live, with whom you can live. It segregates the town to try to keep the workers from unifying too much because they do not want to see a very strong union. Here's the old town, and you see that football field down. You can see the smelter to the south, and this is facing south. I want you to keep in mind this picture. The football field was a very interesting place. You could only kick extra points at one end of the field because at the other end of the field was a 100-foot cliff. So you didn't want to kick your football down the 100-foot cliff. So everybody kicked the field goals and extra points from same end. But again, contextualize this picture. Keep it also in mind. Ultimately, they'll add another smelter or a smokestack. But during this day and time, this is the town. It's a segregated town. Again, the company kept everyone segregated. They told you what color you could paint your house. They told you what. They took the paycheck, they took the electric bill out, they took the gas bill out, took the cable bill out, they took all elements. So again, this is not a normal town in many ways, and that's important to keep in mind. So this is the group of 9 young men I study that will leave July 4th, 1966. They're all members of the class of 1966 except Stan King. Stan had gone off, he was the class of 1964, he had gone off to the University of Arizona, which is hard for anyone that's a professor at Arizona State to ever say those words, but occasionally I have to. He'd gone off to the U of A and was studying engineering. But the majority of the rest were a cross-section of the town. Leroy Cisneros, Robo Moncayo, Clive Garcia. They represent the Mexican-American part of the community, which is about half the community of 5,000. The others are Van Whitmer, Larry West, Mike Cranford, and again, Stan King and Bobby Draper. They also represent a cross-section. Their fathers either worked in the mine or they worked in the smelter. And finally, there was Joe Sorrelman, who was Navajo. Neither of his parents spoke English. His father worked in the mine. He'd go home at night and translate TV for them. He was the youngest, and he would oftentimes look at the materials that he was provided by his uncles who were code talkers during World War II. So this group is fairly representative. Only Stan and Bobby Draper were what would be considered college material. Bobby was the All-American kid, all-state linebacker. Some thought he would go off to a university and play football, but he didn't. He decided the day that the Marines, and here's what happens. In March of 1966, a Marine recruiter comes over from Globe, Arizona, about 2 hours away, another mining town. In the process of that, he goes and he tells the school officials, please send me students to come talk to me. Well, that same day, the majority of these young men are in their English class. Miss Arnold, who fit every stereotype of an English teacher, up to the glasses that she wore, decided she was announced she was going to give them a pop quiz. Well, the principal shows up and says, if you go and meet the Marine recruiter, you don't have to go, or you don't have to take the pop quiz. They run over each other trying to get out the door. But ultimately, the Marine recruiter tells them stories about how they might seek adventure beyond the mines. Keeping in mind, their fathers worked in this 1966 period on a contract of 26 days on, 2 days off. So they're looking for something. They also know the draft is hanging over them, and that if they don't join, they'll eventually get caught up. And their argument is going to be, well, if we're going to go, we're going to go with the Marines, because the guys in the Army are all a bunch of draftees, and we don't want to be with those bunch of zeros. I think that's exactly the quote Joe said. So they end up joining the Marine Corps. They defer until July 4th, 1966, when they head off to boot camp. And I love this quote of why they joined. And I think it's beyond just the draft. There's many levels to it. And I spent a whole chapter in the book talking about this. Mike Cranford, one of the guys, said, we were small town people. We still believed in mom and apple pie. It was part of my duty as a man. And I think that's an extremely important line. Growing up to join the service, they didn't have to draft us. It was part of what we were supposed to do. Remember this quote and contrast it. Well, they go to San Diego as a group, and they'll go into this training platoon, 1055. September of 1966 is picture. They get there in July, they'll graduate in September. And unfortunately for them, they inherited an archetype of the Marine drill instructor, the one that questioned their manhood as soon as they showed up, the one that liked to dip snuff, and he joked that if you moved while he was yelling at you, you were going to get extra punishment. And he liked to also see how much he could put in your ear canal of the dip and the spit that would come out. Sergeant Bowser. It was important for them to be there together, though. They helped each other. Bobby Dell, the one I was telling you about, was probably about 6 foot, 205 pounds. Didn't really do good in long distance running. So at times, his friends would have to pick up the pack and help him through those long runs. In another case, Van Whitmer cut through the line of another platoon at lunch, and a fight broke out, and his friends had to come in and save him. So it made a difference. Each night, they'd read to each other letters from home. They'd talk about what they were going to do when they finished boot camp. They'd talk about their girlfriends. They'd talk about all these things, sort of help keep them going and keep each other going. But boot camp was not easy, but they did fairly well. But I like this quote, Clive Garcia, the archetype of the Marine, 5'10", 195 pounds, could be mean as a snake when he needed to be. Clive writes home to his mom and dad, quote, they work us harder than the average college student, but there's a reason. We are learning how to kill while the college student is learning how to live, end quote. Think about that. They graduate together. Here is Clive Garcia with Robert Moncayo. Here's the group minus Van Whitmer with the collar guard person who was elected. And they don't get much time. Boot camp has diminished from 12 weeks to 8 weeks because they need more troops to serve in Vietnam. They go to advanced infantry training. It's only 2.5 weeks rather than the longer version that existed before 1965. And then Four of them jump on a ship and head to South Vietnam in December of 1966. Think about this. You graduate in May of 1966, and by December of 1966, you're on a boat heading to fight in Vietnam. Think of that, how quick that was, the transformation. This is the General Gaffney. And on the way over, they stay together. They even get into a brawl in a bar in Okinawa together because some Puerto Ricans were questioning Leroy Cisneros and his loyalty to those white boys. They get in this huge brawl right there in Okinawa. Well, the first one to land, and the first one is 2 days out from their ship arriving, the General Gaffney, outside of Da Nang, South Vietnam, Leroy Cisneros gets his orders. His orders are, and he opens them up, and his face flushes. And they ask him, what's wrong? He got assigned to recon. And if you know anything about the Marine Corps, that's one of the toughest duties that you can draw. 5 to 7 people going out into the middle of the jungle, searching for the enemy, constantly afraid that you're going to be overwhelmed by the enemy when they discover you. You're not there to fight them. You're there to locate them so they can bring in larger forces to destroy them. But think about that. Only 5 to 7 people in the middle of the enemy territory. Here, Leroy. And not only does Leroy take on recon without any training, within the first few missions, he becomes a point man. And he's got some miraculous stories. In the case of this, at one point, he walks through an ambush because he's point man. And they wait till the main body comes up before they hit. And all he can hear is when they hit him hard, all he can hear is grenades landing on each side of him. And all he do is roll over and try to go away from the grenades. Roll over another time. Takes time to say a prayer to God. God, please, if you get me out of this, I promise I'll go to church every Sunday after this. Well, he made it. And no, he did not go to church every Sunday after that. But he did watch people die in his arms. And in a year, he did 43 missions as a point man on recon and survives. Well, Joe Soroman, the Navajo that I told you about, Joe got the best duty of any of the people on the General Gaffney, guarding an air base at Chulai, where basically he saw no combat. He lived in a barracks. He had 3 hot meals a day. But Joe wanted to see combat. And here's something, if you ever join the Marine Corps, that I would encourage you not to do. That is, ask for combat roles because they will honor it. And Joe went from guarding an air base and an easy, cushy job, he went from that to the area around what was called Leatherneck Square in Contien in the summer of 1967. And anybody that knows anything about the Vietnam War knows in 1967, the summer, the heaviest fighting was taking place in Contien, near the demilitarized zone. He immediately started questioning his choices. And the thing that he learned to hate most was artillery, because you couldn't fire back at the enemy. And they'd launch artillery attacks from North Vietnam into U.S. bases across the DMZ, and you couldn't fire back. Well, Joe survived, several times barely not being blown apart. And he had a miraculous story. One day, he's coming back in, and their rifle company's coming back in from a 2-week mission. As they come in, the North Vietnamese open up on them with their artillery, and they all jump into the bar ditch. After the barrage is over, the Marine lieutenant starts calling out names to make sure nobody's been hit. As he's calling out the name, and as he gets to Joe's name, the chaplain comes running up. I've been looking for you for 2 weeks. Your brother's sick. You need to go home. Joe said, well, I hesitated because it was 2 weeks. But his lieutenant pulling him aside says, you're leaving tomorrow. That night, they got hit by the MVA inside their perimeter, and Joe goes, I think I will leave tomorrow. The next day, he's standing at the helicopter pad just outside of Contien. As he's doing that, the helicopters are coming in for resupply. And as they come in, they're hitting very hard because the enemy are firing artillery, and they're just trying to get off the ground. So they just throw things out, hit the ground hard, and take off. But Joe tries to time his run across the pad to catch one of those helicopters. And he does. He starts running. And he can feel the shrapnel falling on him from the enemy fire. And he runs. He throws his pack and his weapon up into the helicopter. And as he jumps, he misses. and he ends falling on the skid underneath the helicopter. And he's lifted off the ground as he's hanging on, and they're trying to reach down and pull him in. I'm sure there was an NVA forward observer going, man, that guy wants to get the heck out of here. He made it. He made it home to the Navajo Nation where near Gallup, where his brother had passed away by that point. So he goes back to Morenci for a week or so, and then he goes back to San Diego where he thinks he's going to be sent back to Vietnam. But he's short, doesn't have much time left, so they decide not to send him back. And one day while he's at Camp Pendleton, he sees a friend of his from Vietnam. And the friend comes across, and they hug, and they start exchanging stories. And the friend goes to Joe, do you know what just happened to your group the day after you left? Joe goes, no, I haven't seen anybody. He goes, they went out and they got ambushed and only one walked away. That's how close he came to death, and he knew it. Well, not everybody was so fortunate. The All-American kid, Bobby Dell. Here he is. I love this picture of him smiling. His parents gave me this. That was pretty much Bobby Dell. Well, what's funny here is he starts at this marine company working outside of Anhui in December of 1967. And in late July of 1967, he comes to Leroy's camp just outside of Da Nang. He'd been fighting. He'd been off in Tokyo doing his R&R. Well, he and Leroy get stinking drunk and pass out in a trench. But before that, Leroy had said, Bobby, you're late getting back to your unit. Bobby goes, aren't you afraid? Leroy goes, aren't you afraid of what they're going to do to you? Bobby just looks at him and goes, what are they going to do? Send me to Vietnam? Well, a few days after this picture on the right, when he and Leroy had celebrated heavily and then promised that they were going to hold a big party when they get back, a few days later, Bobby Dell's unit goes out and gets slaughtered. Everyone shot extra in the head before the rapid force can deploy. He's the first to die. August 2nd, 1967. Stan King. Remember the one that had been off to the University of that other place? He'd arrived, and 2 weeks into his tour of duty, he's killed in an operation in the exact same area that Bobby Dell was killed. Same unit, actually. Different platoon. That same night that he's killed, his mother wakes up. She's screaming. She'd had a nightmare. She'd seen Stan shot going into a hooch. Her husband goes, no, honey. It's just a bad night. It's just a nightmare. A few days later, though, she's working at the high school cafeteria. And her husband walks in with some Marine officers, and she knows what's happened. Stan's dead. This is November of 1967. Two. The irony is many of these young men are fighting in Vietnam and sending their combat pay back to their parents who have been locked out by the company. There's an ongoing strike that will last almost 9 months. A lot of people would question, why are they fighting for a system where their parents are locked out by this major multinational corporation? But the pain didn't stop then. April, following the Tet Offensive, the Marines started pulling in more people to send to Vietnam to replace those that are either being killed or they're finishing their duty. Van Whitmer had been there 6 weeks, and in March of 1968, an enemy sniper shoots him in the head and kills him. That's three. Keep in mind, the odds of being killed in Vietnam, if you looked at the overall numbers, were about 8% among combat units. Think about that, 8%. Well, in this case, we've taken nine young men. Three are already dead, 33%. They're already exceeding the statistical statistics. Again, Larry West. He actually survived his first tour of duty, came back stateside, had a girlfriend turn down his marriage proposal, had the MPs arrest him off site because he wasn't wearing a belt, and he said, forget this nonsense. I'm going to go back to Vietnam where I know what I'm doing, and I'm going to try to help those young men survive. But one night, he's sitting at the bowling alley as he's getting ready to go. He reaches out his hands to the local high school football coach. Says, it's been nice knowing you. The coach protests. Larry, don't talk like that. Says, Coach, I got lucky the first time. I won't make it back this time. May 17th, 1968. Ironically, working in an area that had been tapped as the Arizona Territory, his group runs into a Viet Cong ambush. And here he is, and you can take this straight out of the Marine Corps maps. One of these people right here is Larry. They even noted where they fell, how he died, May 17th, 1968. Four out of the five now, or four now. But it didn't stop there. Robert Mukayo. If I said Clive Garcia was the stereotype of a Marine, Robert Mukayo was the exact opposite. Soft-spoken, ladies' man. I always say, and you younger people won't get this, but some of the older mind, I always say he's a cross between Tyrone Power and Ricardo Montalban. The older people will get that, and some of you younger will not. Handsome. He got the best duty of everyone after basic boot camp. They sent him to Hawaii where he served as a horse wrangler that would take people out on beach rides, especially the Marine officers' wives and children, and walk right up and down the beach. However, again, the losses pile up in the Tet Offensive, and Robert is pulled into the net. Before he leaves, he goes out on his girlfriend's yacht, and they have a big celebration. But he ends up just outside of Khe Sanh. Some of the heaviest fighting of the war is taking place in June of 1968. 3 weeks into his service, they go out on an operation. They get surrounded one night by the North Vietnamese. And they start probing their perimeter. And at 6 o'clock in the morning, they hit. And they start pouring through the lines of his unit. And somewhere along the line, he's ordered to go meet the incoming North Vietnamese. And he dies a gunshot in the back. 3 weeks into his tour of duty. Well, that only leaves a couple of people. Mike Cranford goes, serves. Worst injury he has is heat stroke. He's a radio telegraph operator. He survives. Leroy comes home. They keep saying, we'll go back. He says, no. Made it the first time. They say the same thing to Joe. We'll give you a big promotion. Joe says, nope, made it the first time. I've done my duty. Send someone else. Well, that only leaves Clive Garcia. And again, I use Robert as one end, Clive as the other. Clive actually was very upset. He wanted to be in the first group that went to Vietnam. But they wouldn't send him. First, they sent him to Guam, which he hated because he got to be an MP. He said Guam was just not his cup of tea, and he wanted to be in Vietnam. But Clive was very successful. He was an expert shot, as were most of these young men, because they've been raised on hunting their whole life. He's also tough as nails. He even was so good that he got selected when President Johnson came to Guam in 1967. He was selected as part of the honor guard. So he was very successful. He was so good that when he came back from Guam, they sent him to Army Ranger Training School. And so here he is at the bottom with friends that are all Army going through Ranger training. And he succeeds. But during this, he also has to deal with a significant issue. And that is, he has to bring Robert's body home. Here he is with his mother, Julia Garcia. And Julia liked to say two things. One was, every time they saw a Marine car or a Marine officer coming to town, everybody started praying, please don't stop at my house. It became so commonplace. She also talked about how it always seemed that she was making tortillas when the deaths were announced. And she commented they were always saltier from the tears of hers that would fall into the tortillas. Here is Clive as he's accompanied. And you can sort of see in the background the smelter. They live in this segregated part where they put Mexicans far to the south. He writes on the back of this photo, your eyes are swollen. You've cried too much, Mama. Life really itself really isn't that bad. We only have a few sad moments. And all we can do is accept and live with the reality. June of 1968. Ultimately, Clive gets engaged. He goes through recon training in Camp Pendleton, again through Ranger training. As you see, he's wearing his black beret, just to symbolize that. And about the time he starts going, well, maybe I don't want to go to Vietnam, that's when the Marines honor his request and send him to Vietnam. At the same time, they're starting to withdraw troops. Here he is, and if you look at his eyes, you see a man that has seen way too much in just a few months. He's got that distant look. He's seen several of his soldiers blown up in an Amtrak and burned to death. He killed a child in a crossfire during a firefight. It's hard for him to process. And again, just looking at his eyes just a few months in. Well, ultimately, Clive makes a mistake trying to defuse a booby trap in late November of 1969 and dies. Here he is, the last of the funerals of the nine. The church that they're actually doing here, or giving the ceremony here, they had to actually put plastic over the windows because they're removing the church and moving it to a different place because the mine is swallowing the old town. That's his younger sister going down and the Irish priest in this old Catholic church. Again, that won't, you cannot go there any longer. Here he is to it, the woman to the far left is his fiance, 19 years old, burying her fiance. That's his mother in the middle and his father just to the left of that. He had been a World War II veteran, had fought in the South Pacific and the Philippines and other battles, had seen combat. He knew it. But this is his son and the tears. And you see this when Julia Garcia stands over her son's coffin and whispers, "Thank you for being my son. Oh, dear, my dear boy, thank you so much." Think of burying your child at age 20, 21, or younger. Here's his gravesite. Time Magazine, ABC News, all the major newspapers, Los Angeles Times, come and cover the story. They want to know why. Why so much suffering in this small town? How do you explain it? This is Clive's. This is Robert's. I'm sure Clive did not think he'd be there when he stood there in June of 1968, but he was. And a journalist asked Larry West's mother a very poignant question. Quote, "I don't know what," and she answers, "I don't know what the president would say about it, but I think those Morenci boys now in Vietnam should come home if they want to. It doesn't seem right that such a small town should give so much," end quote. A journalist covering, he says, quote, "Men who have spent a lifetime of working 26 straight days before getting 2 days off, they're not devoid of emotion or inured to tragedy, but they have learned to cope with setbacks better than most of us." You remember that first shot I showed you of the football field? This is what this town looks like now. So not only were they burying their dead, they were burying the town and the grief that came with that. Here's the mine. Massive undertaking that is still being expanded on a daily basis. Leroy Cisneros, one of the survivors, was a strong supporter of my project from the beginning. And he said this to a reporter once, "I don't want them to be forgotten because they sacrificed their lives," of his six friends. "Those guys have been dead for 30 years, but not in my mind. I want my kids to know, at least know, that Bobby Draper, their dad's best friend, died in Vietnam for a good reason." It wasn't always easy, and often very difficult. This is Mike Cranford. You remember that first one I said about mom and apple pie? Here's his quote in 1993. He complains, "Vietnam was a lower middle class war. If you had money, you went to college. I didn't go because I wanted to. I went because I was too stupid to know better," end quote. Suffering from undiagnosed PTSD, he said to a reporter, a survivor's guilt, quote, "I felt guilty. I came home. I never saw the Kings. I found myself avoiding the Garcias, and I never talked to Bobby's dad." If you look closely at the picture, this is his wife, Joyce. And Mike was such a fascinating character. First time I saw him, he pulled up on his Harley, and he looked like Ted Nugent had just arrived. As he sat there and folded his newspapers, or his cigarettes, as we did 3 hours worth of interviews. Across his forehead is a tattoo. He's suffering horribly from PTSD. Everybody around him sees it, but he won't get treatment. That's what pansies went and did. And that's not the word he used. But across his forehead, it was A-M-I-I-G-F. And he wanted you to ask him what it stood for. Ask me if I give a, and I'll let you fill in the last word. He also started having tattoos of crosses placed on his arms with the names of his friends that died in Vietnam. He ultimately got treated for PTSD and then died a year later of a heart attack. His family blaming his experiences in Vietnam and his survivor's guilt for contributing to his early death. Vietnam, and these guys have been memorialized. Of course, there's the Vietnam Memorial, where they are with more than 58,000 other names. And I tell a poignant story about Kathy Garcia, the little girl that you saw in the funeral, and going to the first time to see the Vietnam Wall in 1986 and trying to find her brother's name. She talked about going to the wall. And as she walked down the wall, first of all, she gets to the place where you check for the names. And you look where they are on the panel. And she said she was glad it was covered because the tears would have soaked it. Then she walks down and she kept going towards Clive's name at 16W. And she said all she could think about were all those names. Then she gets to Clive's and then she says this. Then my eyes locked on his name and my knees buckled a little. And the sobbing was uncontrollable. Lots of people were all around, but I didn't care. I squatted down and I rubbed my finger over his name. She eventually took some pictures and left. But as she goes, all she can think about, all those names. There are other efforts to memorialize the Morenci Nine. This is Mike and Leroy at the dedication ceremony for a memorial just outside the new high school. Again, their old high school is buried. New high school by the flagpole, honoring the Morenci Nine. There are also other memorials. This is on a bluff called Mars Bluff. And there was a dog tag strung under the pictures, or under the flagpoles. To the farthest left, the first six names that were ever added were those of the Morenci Nine that died. A final rejoinder. This is a story that has unique characteristics, but it also shares many with places all across the country. Steve Guzzo, who I've always said Tommy Chong would play in a movie, if we ever have a movie made on this. And some of you are like, who? But Tommy Chong would be my choice. But Steve always said about this. He says this, and he's from Clifton. He's a Vietnam veteran himself. What brought it home relating to the Vietnam veterans, what made the impact was the Morenci Nine. However, he added, quote, we can't forget our other people either. And that's the other part of the story that I think is so powerful. It's a universal story. Whether from people from Bellsville, Ohio, to Bardstown, Kentucky, to War, West Virginia, to Thomas Edison High School in Philadelphia that lost 54 students, this is a universal story with unique characteristics. And it cannot be forgotten. It should not be forgotten. And hopefully this book and others, like we had a PBS documentary called On Two Fronts, Latinos in Vietnam, cover. It will not be forgotten. Thank you very much.
So we've got about 10 minutes for questions. Please come up to the microphone and also invite you to tell us your name and what you're studying. Go ahead.
My name is Michael Hansen. I'm an applied mathematics major. I was just wondering what got you onto this story and what made you want to eventually write the book about it.
That's a good question. And let me tell you something we have in common. My first degree is in mathematics. I didn't go into history until after I finished my math degree. Much to the great consternation of my parents when I
decided to do that my senior year in college. But I fell in love. I read a newspaper article. This is where history can come from. And I'll tell you the exact day, April 30th, 2000. I walked out of my house in Gilbert, Arizona, picked up the newspaper, walked in, and there was this full-page story on the Morenci Night, mainly the survivors. And I looked at it and I go, that's more than just a newspaper article. We've got to do more. So I decided to write the book. Now, I wrote four other books in between writing that, when I started this. So that story stuck with me for at least, well, it still sticks with me today. But I read that article and I go, there's so much more to this story. I'd had a wonderful high school history teacher who was a Vietnam veteran that had shared his stories back in the mid-1980s. And so that had planted a seed that I never thought would come to fruition. Again, I thought I was going to get my PhD in mathematics, and that was where I was going to go. But this stood out to me. It just had so much there. And I think if you hear the presentation, even if you haven't read the book, you'll go, that is a powerful story. So I always say, keep your eyes open. I found my biography of Senator Albert Gore Sr. by going on a job interview at Middle Tennessee State University. And they come across, one person comes and says, well, we got all these materials here. Nobody's worked with them. Why don't you come back and work with them? I didn't get the job, but I did come back and work with them. So there's history to be seen everywhere. As long as you listen and as long as you pay attention. Maybe not all are books, but maybe it's an article, maybe it's a report, whatever it may be. Excellent question.
My name is Nate. I'm a political science major. My question is, you talked about how the town was racially segregated by the company. Did the losses from the Vietnam War kind of cross those racially segregated lines? Like, was the community able to overcome that tension?
That's another excellent question. I was just actually asked this in the radio interview. During the day, they weren't as segregated. So the kids went to same schools together. So it wasn't like being in the South, for example, or even in some parts of the country where Mexicans were kept in certain schools and, you know, there was segregation. So during the day, they would interact, but at night, you went home. And the interaction stopped there. Parents would not allow interracial dating. So, you know, that was another taboo. And I was raised in a small West Texas town called Andrews.
Odessa.
Okay, so you know. Yeah. I always joke, you want to know my life story? Just read Friday Night Lights. My dad was a Texas football coach for 43 years. My brother's finishing his 26th year.
Oh, man.
So I'm the only one who didn't go into the family business. But living in Andrews gave me a very strong insights into this story. Because, I mean, it was predominantly Mexican-American in Andrews. The oil just replaced oil with copper. We weren't one company, it was about five.
Right.
And so, you know, working class, a lot of this, social construction of masculinity, everything that tied into it. And so that was how it sort of all played out. And so we knew, and this was in the early to mid-80s, your parents weren't going to, they were going to frown, most parents were going to frown if you dated somebody different ethnicity or a different religion. You wanted to cause a stir in a town of 8,000, that was a good way to do it. So I understood this, and I understood during the day you could come together, but at night it went right back. So that segregation, ultimately the segregation ends in 1969 because the companies, the CEO of the company or who's heading the operation says, this is just ridiculous. And when her husband, who was like the mayor, governor, pretty much ran the whole town, decided it was enough. But it didn't happen until 1969. Excellent question, though. Others?
My name is Shaylin Rogers. I'm a public health major. And I was just wondering, you talked a little bit about how once the boys were buried and didn't come home, that the town was kind of buried. And I'm not sure if I missed the explanation of why, but I was wondering if you could give a little more explanation of that.
Excellent. The main explanation is the company was expanding the mine. The mine is still expanding. You can't believe how big this thing is. If you ever get a chance to go to Morenci, Arizona, go. If you want to see a large industrial mammoth operation, they just Freeport-McMoRan just invested $1 billion into some new equipment. And so the mine just swallows it. And so it, even today, it's still just, they build it out a little bit more. And when copper prices are over $3, it expands quickly. Where they are right now, it's slowed down. So the sort of metaphorical burial of the town parallels the burial of the young men.
Okay.
So I think there's an interesting literary tie there.
Thank you.
Excellent.
My name's Jordan. I'm an international relations major. But I was just wondering, obviously there's like many takeaways and lessons that you can learn from these stories and books, but what is something that you would hope that your readers would take away and do from reading your book?
I think the last chapter is one of the most important, and it talks about memory. How do you remember these kind of people? Where does it fit? Here's my fundamental question, and I use this in my Vietnam War class, this book. And so I ask my students this fundamental question. Where does this fit? Is this about a story about sorrow, or is it about pride? And I let the reader try to reach that conclusion on their own. And everybody has to walk away from it. A lot of times their own background influences it. But I let the reader reach that. I mean, I have my perspective as a father of a 16-year-old, and the thought of losing my 16-year-old in a couple of years is, you know, some days I wish for that, but, you know, most days, I probably shouldn't say this publicly, but some days you wonder about that. But, you know, just dealing with that, how do you see this story? Is it one of patriotism? Is it one of pride? Is it one of sorrow? Is it one of loss? Is it one of loss for no reason? And I've tried to let the reader do that and make that choice. Yes, ma'am.
I'm Haley Dobbs. I'm a communication disorders major at BYU. So I was wondering, through your research, have you found that your perception has changed of whether or not the U.S. should have gotten as involved as they did in the Vietnam War?
I have a fairly easy answer.
Mm-hmm.
No.
No?
No. And the reason I say that is I had pretty much, I had the great honor to study my doctoral studies with the premier scholar of the Vietnam War, George Herring, wrote a book called America's Longest War that is still considered the standard. So a lot of my ideas and I were already set. But what I tried to do as a historian is not let those interfere with how I set the story up.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's trying to secure objectivity is one that we'll never fully obtain, but you try to do so to the best of your ability. So no, I don't really think it. If anything, the loss just sort of reinforced what I already felt. You know, I can't, as a parent, I just can't envision burying my own children
mm-hmm.
in something like this.
Right. Thank
Great
you.
Great question.
All right, well, we're out of time. Thanks for your questions, and please join me in thanking Professor Longley.